Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Economy and Fair Work Committee in 2021. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 4 and 5, which is discussion of evidence, which we hear this morning, in private. Is everybody content? Our main item of business this morning is the second evidence session on our inquiry into Scotland's supply chain. This is the committee's first inquiry. We are looking at the short and medium-term structural challenges facing Scotland's supply chain and how the challenges and shifts in supply chains are impacting Scotland's economy. We want to consider how to build future resilience and whether there are opportunities to develop domestic supply chains. Our inquiry is structured around three themes of people, places and product. Today's session is the second of our people session, looking at skills provision in Scotland. And can I thank the panel for joining us this morning. Welcome to Chris Brodie, who's Director of Regional Skills Planning and Sector Development at Skills Development Scotland. Mary Hendry, who's Deputy Director of External Engagements and Partnerships at Open University. Paul Little, Vice Chair of the College Principals Group, College of Scotland. And Richard McClellan, Director, Qualifications for Industry. Thank you very much for coming in this morning. I'd like to ask an introductory question, which all panel members will get an opportunity to answer. The inquiry has been prompted by committee concerns around supply chains. We are seeing blockages and difficulties within supply chains that are impacting on consumers and on the economy and businesses as they struggle to either get people and also get the components that are needed within existing supply chains. So I'm interested in how your organisations are able to be responsive and fast moving to the pressures we're seeing. Because the submissions we've received from yourselves, which have been very welcome, a lot of time they focus on the longer term challenges that Scotland faces. And you know, there is a broader debate to be had about that. But I suppose the committee were interested in how do we address some of the real shortages and pressures and delays that the current supply chain issues are putting on to our economy. So I'll first of all come to Chris Brodie from Skills Development Scotland. And we have previously heard from Skills Development Scotland. And you know, you do have a focus on medium and long-term challenges in Scotland's economy. But what are you able to do that is more responsive and can respond to immediate challenges that we're facing?
Okay, thank you. Excuse me, thank you and good morning. It's a really great question. I am going to just say as an opening statement, though, that the challenges that we're facing in the labour market at the moment, in particular in terms of people supply, have long-term roots and have long-term solutions. So that focus on the root causes of the problem and addressing these challenges in the long term is really important. And I hope we have an opportunity to talk about some of that today. Notwithstanding that, it's clear that the challenges that we're facing in the labour market at the moment are pretty strong. They are as a result of, I think, a number of things. We have got record levels of recruitment activity going on in the Scottish labour market at the moment and across the UK. So, you know, job vacancies are higher now than they were, or rather job postings are higher now than they were pre the pandemic. And that, in a sense, is a good thing given the challenging 18 months that we've been through. I think what we've also seen as a major contributing factor is a choke on labour supply. And that choke on labour supply has a set of reasons behind it. Some of it is related to challenges around Brexit. Some of it is related to the choices that people have made in respect of being engaged in the labour market. A large part of it is down to economic inactivity. So the challenge that we're seeing at the moment in terms of people supply is down to both an excess of demand, which is a good thing, and a deficit in terms of people. To come to the question about what we're doing to be agile around that, I think partly the answer I've given explains some of it. So we are working very hard to understand the reality of the labour market at the moment and where pressure points are. So I have a team of sector leads who are engaged with industry leadership groups, industry trade bodies, and we are collating and feeding that information into government, into colleges, into training providers to ensure that the system is positioned to respond. Specifically at the moment, we're working on the deployment of the National Transition Training Fund. So that's seeing us deploy, the overall value of the fund is close to £20 million. That money is not just controlled by SDS. Some of that money is dispersed through colleges and other agencies. But we've been working very hard to get around about £4.5 million worth of activity deployed across about 20 projects, ranging from childcare, seafood, creative industries, digital skills, and others. And that's a really important part, I think, of ensuring that, that people who are and employers who are looking to recruit have got the ability to reskill or upskill people who are looking for jobs. We've also just recently established a Green Jobs Workforce Academy looking to provide support and access to training, access to support and information on jobs to people who are looking to move into emerging green skills. So I'll stop there and allow others to come in, but no doubt you'll come back to me through this morning.
Thank you. Mary Hendry.
Good morning. Thank you, everyone. The Open University is the largest provider of part-time education in Scotland. We've got about 55% of all part-time learners and over 22,000 at the moment. And we very much believe that to be able to recover from the kind of economic issues that we've got at the moment, we need to enable access to education for all. What we've been doing recently is actually looking at our curriculum and making sure that the products that we have and the services out are actually fit for that purpose, to be able to do exactly as you said, being able to respond quickly to the issues and being able to retrain people. So we're already providers of modular education. So we have got part-time learners right across the whole of Scotland. 75% of them are in work and learning at the same time. And we know that 75% of them earn under £25,000 because they access the part-time fee grant. What we've been doing over the course of COVID and in response to Brexit, as well as working with individuals and with businesses to offer out those modules, utilising the part-time fee grant, but also utilising the Scottish Government and SFC-funded programmes like the Upskilling Fund, the National Transition Training Fund, and we're also the only university who's got access to the Flexible Workforce Development Fund to work with SMEs and offer them up to £5,000 of training. So we're offering a modular curriculum. We've also developed a large suite of micro-credentials, which are 10 and 15 credit upskilling courses in those areas where we know that there are skills gaps, where industry has told us that there's gaps. So in IT, in areas of sustainability, health and social care, in these sort of areas. And we're able to offer quite a few of those out free because we've got access to the funding pots as well. So in terms of response to supply chain, what we have done during COVID is we've worked with organisations like Skills Development Scotland, with PACE, with industry bodies like the FSB, to actually look at the sectors and see where are the skills needed and actually focus in campaigns to get to the people who were furloughed or might have been facing redundancy or looking to upskill. So we worked with organisations like Michelin, who were going through a redundancy, to get their staff upskilled and reskilled, particularly in areas of green technology, technical skills, because the benefit of part-time education is that you can study it while you're still working and reskill and upskill. And I think the focus that we've been looking at is, you know, that sector, looking at young people. Yes, there's been a big focus on that, but actually about upskilling and reskilling the population. And been able to do it in a quick and modular fashion that means that people can get qualifications or skills very quickly to look at this. We've also been working on our Open Learn content. So the Open University's mission is very much about a social mission. So we offer at least 10% of our courses free and online in our Open Learn course. And during the pandemic, we accessed 7 million people accessed that free learning. We worked again with SDS to get our Open Learn content put onto My World of Work. On the first day of launch, there was 24,000 people accessed that. And we've been working with sectors like the college sector, working with teachers, working with the unions and union learning to actually get people online. So we've used the pedagogy that we've got and offered out free courses and funded micro-credentials to enable people who are educators to be able to take their content online, so that industry bodies and other educators are able to, you know, take what was courses that people had to come in and sit in a classroom and been able to take that online. So we've offered that out as well. So that's a kind of snapshot of some of the stuff that we've done kind of over the last 18 months to look at that kind of supply and try and get the demand, get people skilled up in that area quickly.
That's great. Thank you. Paul Little.
Good morning. Many of you will know that the college sector is the jewel in the crown of tertiary education. So I'm not going to rehearse the breadth of the college education, although for some of you, you may be surprised to learn there's 23,000 courses and we serve about 250,000 learners in Scotland. And of course, when times are plenty or indeed when times are difficult as they are now, the college sector is there right across 13 regions as civic anchor institutions and as economic anchor institutions. I think the challenge that you face here is your three central themes of people, place and product. And I would commend to you the Cumber for Little report that was commissioned by the ministers last year. It was published just in February before the pandemic, so somehow it's got over eclipsed by a health crisis. But in essence, it's a blueprint for what you're seeking to achieve here, because we say from the very front cover, it's about taking an agile and inclusive and a collaborative approach to both economic development, business support, and indeed lifetime learning. And the institutions that go right across Scotland, you know, geographically well spread, but they've got expertise that date back many years. For example, my own is a centre of excellence in procurement and supply chain by the industry lead body. We're responsible for, you know, upskilling and reskilling the supply chains of many economic sectors and the sector itself in supply chain. And we've been doing that for 17 years. We've also engaged in people of procurement for tomorrow, and we've been helping a number of companies provide the skills and workforce, for example, to inward investment, such as Barclays in a fast-track programme for either 13 weeks or 6 weeks. Now, that's phenomenal when you consider that we normally talk about 4 years or 3 years. To be able to kind of upskill in that sense, micro-credentials were mentioned. You know, we're proposing in that report that micro-credentials should be 20 hours of learning. And if you consider that we're talking of the, if you like, the lower skills or the practical skills of, you know, HGV or fruit pickers, quite honestly, the media hasn't quite got the attention of the medium skills and the higher level skills that are also needed for our competitive economy. And we would be urging in that report and the colleges deliver that, a symbiotic partnership with business and industry. So if you consider that the college sector right across Scotland is hardwired into the SME network, small to medium sized enterprise network, the reality is colleges are very close to supporting those in need, those in future need, and trying to work with the skills agencies to anticipate future demands. And, you know, we've got here in Scotland, as a very cohesive nation, an opportunity to do that. We've got a blueprint to do that. I want to commend that blueprint to you. And I want to say more than that, we've also got a competitive edge here in Scotland. We have been arguing in that report, which was a distillation, if you will, of about 1 year of reference right across the sector and intra and intra the sectors, to look at our competitive edge. And we are proposing the concept of world skills. If you consider we just had COP and everyone in the world came, you know, to Glasgow and to Scotland to find out what we're doing about climate mitigation and climate adaption. But actually what we also are very good at are world skills. So if you consider China, France, you know, all the competitors, Brazil, India, they're all engaging in world skills. It's a movement over 70 years. Scotland punches way above its weight. It leads the UK in its response to that. We send students across the world to showcase the skills, the practical skills, the technological skills that are needed. And we're very much in front of that. What we really need is our skills agencies, particularly our funding council, to pick up the pace. To their credit, they've adopted that from the Cumber for Little report. But we just need them to pick up the pace, because quite honestly, that's going to help us remain competitive as we respond to these urgent and present challenges. So in essence, the college sector as anchor institutions is your national asset for upskilling and reskilling, for technological education, and for the rapid response, the agile response that you need for your three central schemes. And obviously in that, there's some particular initiatives that, you know, happy to discuss further that can really, you know, help particularly the supply chain and procurement and all those areas that are in urgent need of upskilling and reskilling.
Thank you. And Richard McClellan, could you respond to the question about supply chain pressures and how responsive the sector are? Thank
you. I suppose as an employer, the greatest challenge that I have and we have is getting people just now to be able to expand our business. And within that, we're finding that one of the major obstacles is encouraging people to consider career changes. They come out of university and they seem to be tunnel vision towards whatever the title of their qualification is, and then you're trying to get them to consider, say, a career in education that has a focus on, say, construction or civil engineering, and it's quite difficult to get them to think of something different that they feel they might not be ideally qualified to follow as a career. So I'd see it important to encourage people to be multidisciplined and have these world skills and be able to move from career to career at all different stages of their career development, whatever age they are.
Thank you very much. We'll now move on to questions from members. If I could ask members to maybe direct the question to individuals on the panel. We do have quite a large panel this morning, and I would like all members to get a chance to ask questions. So I'll pass over to Michelle Thompson first.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everybody. Chris, if I could direct my opening question to you. I was heartened to read the submission from Skills Development Scotland in that you make it very clear the difference between skills gaps, skills shortages, and labour shortage. And this distinction, in my opinion, is vital if we are to understand the people element of supply chains. Now, I'm sure gaps and shortages, it's already we've started to explore that, and I think other members will want to come in on that. So I want to talk about labour shortages initially. In your submission, you note that labour shortages occur to too few bodies and could be an issue of demographics, economic activity, or reduced inward migration. So I want to understand from an evidential basis what specific impact a lack of inward migration and demographics is having right now, and that can be perceived as structural issues that we need to address. And I'm coming to this from where are we now, as well as I've got another question going on about where we are in the future. So if you could give me your opinion where we are and why that is. And the last wee point is, I'm sure the B word, Brexit, may come in, but what I want to understand is, without inward migration, can we have enough bodies in Scotland? So Chris, thank you.
Okay, and I'm going to preface this by saying I'm going to do the best I can to provide some numbers and some evidence, but we'll almost certainly just make sure that I've got those numbers right around what I'm talking to with a written submission afterwards. So in terms of where we are just now and what's contributing to the challenges, I think there are three challenges, and I hope I remember the third one. The first is around Scotland's kind of challenge of demographics. So we have got a relatively low birth rate, and as a result of that, Scotland's workforce demographics foresee that we, if we do nothing, we'll have fewer working age people in 25 years than we have now, something to the tune of around 130,000, 140,000. In the 10 years prior to 2018, Scotland's population grew by around about 280,000, 290,000. 90% of that population growth was down to in-migration from the rest of the UK and from the EU and overseas. In terms of the migration picture at the moment, it's the evidence that's emerging is suggesting two things: that there are significant numbers of EU nationals who have left Scotland during the pandemic and may not have come back, and also, and this is in part a global phenomenon, the patterns of inward migration across the world have slowed down. But the consequence of Scotland is we expect that migration has fallen quite significantly. That has a detrimental impact on Scottish population. It has a detrimental impact on the availability of working age population. That's not the full story, though, in terms of the challenge. And there's a lot of evidence emerging on the implications of the pandemic, that what that's leading to is a rise in economic inactivity. And I quoted a number around, you know, 280,000 Scots coming into Scotland over a 10-year period through in-migration. The reality is we've got 823,000 economically inactive people in Scotland at the moment. Only about 20% of them are looking for a job. So we've got about 157,000. I'm hoping my arithmetic is holding up well here this morning. We've got about 157,000 people who are looking for a job, but who at the moment can't find one. So I think the focus on increasing labour supply is going to be really important to address these issues. Back to the opening question, some of the solutions to that are not short term. It is not easy to get someone who's been out of work or economically inactive for a period of up to 2 years back into work in 6 weeks' time. But we need a strong focus on inward migration, talent attraction, economic inactivity, and also making it easier for people to upskill and reskill in the way that both Paul and Marie have described.
Thank you very much for that very comprehensive answer. Richard, I wanted to bring you in here as well from the point of view of an industry perspective, particularly around demographics and labour shortages. Have you got something to add to what Chris has said?
Are you talking to me from a civil engineering construction?
Yes, in your area. I'm trying to get to the point where we are very specific about the difference between skills gaps, skill shortages and labour shortages, and understand where are we now with the structural issues with labour shortages. So what you're seeing in your area would be very helpful for the record and for evidence.
What I'm seeing from a positive point of view is a lot of potential work. There's a lot of work out there, and what's choking the whole situation is getting the people to do the work. It's across lots of different sectors. I suppose in particular civil engineering. I feel in relation to civil engineering, it's about attracting people into courses that they want to do and see as courses that are going to allow them to, as I said earlier, develop their careers. I think that's really all I can say on that point.
Convener, if it's okay, I'll just move on to my other area that I mentioned. Paul, I, of course, have read your excellent report with Audrey Comfort, and I've just got a couple of questions around that. It strikes me that you make a very clear case for focusing on excellence rather than just competence. And the point of view of mentioning world skills, it's my understanding that not is it only just a competition, it also develops international standards and therefore enables international benchmarking and increases competitiveness of the contributing countries. Can you confirm if my understanding is correct and give a little more thinking about the move towards excellence from competence that you outline in your report with Audrey Comfort?
Yeah, thank you for those remarks. In a sense, what we're arguing for in that report is that if you teach merely to competence, then the reality is you don't have a competitive edge. If you teach to excellence, or what we describe as proficiency, then the reality is you're giving the inherent transferable skills that individual will need, that technician, that technologist will need to work in a competitive world. And increasingly, regardless of whether it's globalisation or deglobalisation, you're increasingly seeing a movement of human capital. So we would want our young people to stay here in Scotland, but we would want those young people to be able to compete with markets that are beyond Scotland. And you can't do that if you're teaching to merely competence, if you're merely following a syllabus and you're merely acquiring a standard, because that standard will be superseded by those nations that are engaged in upskilling, reskilling at world-class levels. So there are some 80 countries engaged in world skills. And Scotland's coming slow to that, despite the fact that we exceed the UK and top the league, and actually we have students who come fourth in the world in certain skills. We're demonstrating in those skill areas that Scotland can teach in its college sector to the very, very highest levels, and that those highest levels can continue to compete, and that those individuals can continue to develop as, if you will, master technologists or master craftsmen and women as they progress in their careers, either setting up their own businesses or indeed becoming the future lecturers that we need in our colleges and universities. But that standard is a world-class standard. And you're right, if we're able to benchmark, and that standard will change, if you're able to benchmark annually or every 2 years as the competitions engage, for example, next year the competitions are going to be held in China. you know, we will know whether UK and in particular Scotland is going to be competitive in a changing world if our students are successful in that. But that skills infrastructure needs supported. Across the UK, we've hollowed out our skills infrastructure. We've dismantled our polytechnics. We've dismantled our craft skills. And the reality of the situation, this is one of the few things that we have got left to be proud of here in Scotland, and in particular to give our future workers a competitive edge. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now take Maggie Chapman to be followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning to the panel, and thank you for being here. I want to speak a little bit about, and Marie, maybe this is for you initially. You talked about some of the work that you've done about focusing and targeting skills training, some of the micro-credentials in areas. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? Because I think we've heard from evidence previously that there are barriers in some disadvantaged groups of accessing the training, accessing the opportunities for upskilling and reskilling. How is it that we can focus by geography, by demographics, by sector, in specific ways? What is it that you are able to do now, and what are the kinds of things that we need to change to make sure that we can improve that?
Sure, thanks. It's a very good question, and one that we all tackle on a daily basis when we get up in the morning. I mean, I think one of the key things from an Open University perspective is that we offer open access to all of our qualifications for the vast majority of them. I think nursing, there are NMC entry requirements, but for the vast majority of our undergraduates, we offer open access, so you don't need any qualifications to study with us. And 19% of our students have no formal qualifications at all. So actually, the ability to be able to open up access to education for everyone is key to it, you know, actually being able to get to the demographics. We have got 25% of our students who declare a disability and 9% of them mental health issues. That's more than a lot of universities have in total, and it's something that we take very, very seriously in terms of support that we give to people. And what we've found is that the online supported education, you know, you can offer that anywhere, you know. So what we found is that a lot of people find that easier. So we've found a lot of people who've went to your brick-based universities who have struggled with anxiety, who find the online environment easier. And the support that we put in there enables us to be able to do that. The flexibility that it offers in terms of a part-time education that can be studied at any time means that people who've got caring responsibilities, people who need to work part-time, it enables them to be able to work. And as I was saying at the start, 75% of our students are in work, and 75% of them are earning under 25,000. So we know that there will be people within that are actually, you know, kind of in work poverty as well and struggling. We work a lot with care experience and with carers. So we reach into demographics there in terms of the kind of the populations, and the offering that we have generally enables people to do that. The modular basis of the OU means that people can study for the outcome that they need. So it's not about having to study for a full four-year qualification. Sometimes a 30-credit module or a 10-credit module is enough for people. It might actually give them the qualification that enables them to get into Paul's College. It might enable them to, you know, put a skill on their CV that they've got, you know, coding skills that they've been able to develop in a 10-week programme that we can run that shows and demonstrates. So we've done that with retail workers whose job is basically went online. We've been able to retrain them in kind of 10, 12 weeks to be able to show their employers that they've then got those skills. In terms of sectors, we work with SMEs, we work with large businesses, we work with industry bodies, and we do a lot of work with the third sector as well, which is a really important part of the economy that often gets forgotten about when we're talking about organisations that work with people, particularly those who work in the community and who are looking to upskill and reskill. We've also done things like our survey, our business barometer survey, which tells us that 63% of businesses have got a skills gap. The areas that they're telling us that the skills gaps are in management and leadership, particularly technical skills and industry-specific skills. And the sectors which we're seeing the biggest gap were agriculture, fisheries, IT, hospitality, the sort of areas that that are, you know, kind of well determined there. So what we are doing and what we have done is develop our micro-credentials in those areas. And again, most of those don't have any entry qualifications at undergraduate level, the postgraduate ones we do. What we're doing is then targeting those sectors. We're working with organisations like PACE, with SDS, with the industry bodies that are representing those organisations, and actually, you know, promoting free courses and fully funded courses to those sectors and working with them to get people on board with that. So it's kind of multifaceted and multi-layered, but what we're looking at doing is kind of bringing as many people into that pool as possible and getting as many people upskilled and reskilled as we possibly can.
Thanks very much for that. I wonder, Chris, if you wanted to comment on some of that as well, and perhaps particularly you said earlier about the number of economically inactive people. How can we make those connections better?
Sure. I'm not going to add anything to the statement made by Maria around focusing and targeting micro-credentials, which I thought was hugely comprehensive. Let's just look at a moment for where we're seeing inequalities in the labour market, and I'll pick out a couple of issues that I think that are emerging quite quickly, and particularly in relation to economic inactivity. Lots of evidence that older workers are those most at risk of both being made redundant or becoming economically inactive as a result of the pandemic, and particularly older women. So that's a big contributor to the challenge. We're already looking at the extent to which we have got provision in place to support those workers. I think in terms of other inequalities in the labour market, we know that disabled groups, older workers, as I've previously mentioned, and black and ethnic minority groups, labour market outcomes have not shifted at all during the pandemic. They've stayed the gap between those and other workers has remained persistent. So I think it's really important that we've got a focus not just in our upskilling and reskilling provision, but actually through college provision, university provision, and indeed apprenticeships, to ensure that we're making those training routes as open and accessible to all as we can.
Thank you very much for that. And if I can come to you, Richard, I wonder, can you say a little bit more about what it is in one of those skills gaps around leadership, technical skills, what it is that you feel that we need to be thinking about, either at a macroeconomic level or at that sort of focused, targeted level to support the people that you engage with and the organisations, that the companies that you support?
Just now, as a business, for various reasons, we are focusing on the market that's available to us in England. We're doing a lot of work on the English standards-based apprenticeships. And one particular addition to the construction sector, which has been around for a long time, which I feel they're probably getting a bit better with down there than they're doing up here, is things like BIM, building information modelling. And you know, when you start looking at our apprenticeships, some of the framework apprenticeships haven't changed in 10, 20 years. I'm not going to say that what they're doing down there is better than what we're doing up here, but because it's recently changed, they're looking at new things like engineers that are focusing on digital. I would be promoting the whole idea of digital engineering and making sure that our engineers are coming out of university and coming out of apprenticeships with strong digital engineering skills.
Okay, thank you very much. And be rude not to. Paul, is there something you I suppose specifically about the leadership and technical gaps that we're identifying? What is it that we're getting wrong?
Yeah, you've got very comprehensive answers. This is the hard bit coming here. I think what I would focus on is two things in particular, system leadership and cross-silo leadership. I think, you know, the infrastructure here in Scotland is, in my opinion, ahead of England. It's a more managed system here in Scotland, and that's to our advantage. But I do think that we do need a bit of more of a focus and sponsorship in terms of system leadership. We do really need people to work together and to be aligned and to have a shared vision. And I think you have to train for that. You have to actually encourage that. You can't just hope or exhort that that's going to happen. So, you know, what we're missing at the minute is possibly something like a staff college in system leadership, where we can encourage cross-silo working, transition, working on the margins, negotiation, you know, and project management. All those areas are very, very important as we emerge, and more importantly, as we face the next challenge that are coming down the track. And, you know, of course, leadership is key to that, because, you know, not that engenders teamwork, and that actually ensures that everyone is included. And it's a key part of this committee's work to ensure that it's fair work and an inclusive economic growth. And the reality is that can't be left to chance. And in my opinion, it starts with leadership.
Thank you. Thank you, Claire. Yes,
thank you. Fiona Hislop, followed by Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, and it's great to see a panel in real life, so you're very welcome. I wanted to come to Paul first and then to Chris. Paul, clearly colleges are very agile and responsive, but also, as the Cumberford Little report indicated, an engine for economic growth within particular localities. I'm interested in what you're saying about the expertise in supply and procurement, and with the convener's agreement, if those experts haven't put into this inquiry, it'd be very interested to get their take on supply and procurement, because that's exactly what we're looking at in terms of this inquiry. So from your institution, particularly in Glasgow, as an anchor and an engine for economic activity, what are local businesses telling you about the current labour supply issues, and also what are you doing in terms of using your power as a procurer to get sustainability of products and people in the place that you lead in?
Thank you, Fiona. You're very on message. Thank you for the Cumberford Little endorsement there. I think we work very closely with the Chambers of Commerce, and we work very closely with the SMEs and the Federation of Small Business. So we're very close as a metropolitan college, as Edinburgh would be, as colleges would be in their island region, or indeed their kind of other regions right across, and there are 13. They would be aware of these emerging skill shortages, and they would also be particularly, we talk about supply chain. Well, that's a huge expertise that has resided in the Central Belt, particularly in our legacy college, for at least 17 years. And it's never ceased to amaze me why not more people know about that. It's a centre of excellence. It's the industry lead body for the UK. The Chartered Institute of Procurement and Supply Chain Management has designated that, I think, a 3- or 4-star centre of excellence. And there are only 20 of these across the whole of the United Kingdom. And the challenge here is, how do you, upskill, I suppose, industry professionals to work in the supply chain using the skills that the industry say they need to a standard that industry wants? And not every centre can engage in that right up to, we engage it up to master's level at the City of Glasgow College. But they don't actually get a master's qualification, because the industry doesn't want a master's qualification. It wants a level 9 qualification, whereby if you complete the professional, if you like, the chartership qualification, then the industry will allow you to put MSIPs after your name, and they know and trust you to be a lead professional to lead in that supply chain and procurement. So as an institution, we've worked with Scottish Government to provide apprenticeships in supply chain procurement. We've provided HNDs and HNCs in supply chain and procurement, and we've gone further than that to ensure that the charter qualifications that the industry needs, if you like, the leadership dimension that I spoke about earlier, that's at the very, very highest levels. So we've engaged in that with very target initiatives such as procurement, people initiative, and we've gone, in addition to that, we've worked with about some 10,000 employees during the pandemic to upskill and reskill them as part of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. And we've developed 125 digital courses that can be fast-tracked for individuals. And I, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, that when Barclays came in and said, we really need employees and we need 2,000 of them and we need them now, we can't wait 4 years, can you do that in 13 weeks? We said yes, and we delivered that. And when we successfully said, can you do that in 6 weeks? And we said yes, and we delivered that. So that is really an agile solution, and that's replicated by colleges, the Lethbridge, the Scotland, trying to respond, as you said, as anchor institutions, as civic institutions, as economic institutions, if you will, multiplying the economic base of that locality. And clearly, there are some lead institutions that do that on a supply chain and procurement basis, and City of Glasgow is at the tip of the spear of that.
Thank you. I'd also be interested in what your organisation does in your own procurement to help that sustainability as well, but you might want to follow up that later. The other issue I wanted to ask you about was demography. We know that's one of the biggest challenges that Scotland faces, but it's not an equal split across the country. And obviously the west of Scotland is losing population at a faster rate and the east of Scotland is gaining that. Now that's a challenge, and I'm asking you this with your hat on as the Association of Scottish Colleges, because in my part of the world, there's students that won't be able to get into the local college in West Lothian that would be able to get to in a place in the west of Scotland because there are more places available. We have more, a bigger population, we have a growing population, but we also with that growing population have a growing demand for labour and skills. Is the Funding Council, do you think, as agile and responsive as it could be in recognising the immediate issues that we really face in terms of labour supply to ensure that where there are people, and young people in particular, they can be supported to make sure that we're getting that volume of trained young people into the workforce?
OK. I'll briefly answer your question on procurement because that's an easy one. Colleges and universities all are centralising their procurement through APUC, which is a centralised procurement provider, with a kind of framework, a call-off framework, and we try to do that as green and sustainable as we possibly can, clearly, from COP and clearly value for money. But to your particular question about, you know, the demography and the impact and, you know, the question about the Funding Council, I think in recent years, under Karen Watt's leadership, it has much more agile response than in previous, commendably so. Not just responsible for the Funding Council, but also SDS and other agencies, Scottish Enterprise, SDI, HEI. I think the challenge is, are all those agencies aligned? I'm not convinced they are. And I think that what Cumberford Little, Audrey and I suggested is that they needed to be better aligned than they are now, and they needed to have a shared narrative than they have now. Because the acute challenge you talk about is the kind of demographic movement of the young people west-east. We are fortunate here in Scotland that we've got a very cohesive, collaborative college network. So we can work very closely to try and meet that demand. But we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that because of uncertainty, because of the pandemic, because even of Brexit, the reality is we're facing challenges that we didn't face before, where students are now choosing to stay on at school rather than progress to either college or university, where young people are suggesting that it's probably better for them to go straight into a job if a job's there, and employers are looking for those workers right now because of the demographic downward trend that we've got. So in one sense, is our careers network fit for purpose? No. We need to do something about that, because that clearly, particularly at a school level, will then help those young people navigate across the colleges and across the university and across the kind of wider apprenticeship network to get the courses they need. I think it was ever thus between movement and migration within Scotland, and clearly the net beneficiary of that is the Central Belt, but I think it's also important that we maintain that network right across Scotland, indeed in our island network. And as I said at the start, the Parliament's jewel in the crown for that and your national infrastructure asset is actually the college sector. And I think it does an extremely good job, and the proof is just in the evidence. Over 250,000 people every year, over 23,000 courses, and clearly they're quite geographically spread. And I think, you know, we work increasingly with Edinburgh College in particular, and Edinburgh College works with satellite colleges as we do in the Glasgow area. So we try to ensure that we provide pathways. Sometimes those are very specialist pathways, and sometimes those are only in certain institutions. But the bedrock foundation apprenticeships, and even the access courses and the national award courses, those are well spread throughout east and west of Scotland. So I reassure you, and your own college does a fantastic job.
Yeah, I will let them know that. So coming to Chris, it'd be quite interesting. Can you respond perhaps to some of the points from Paul? We're particularly interested in retail and construction and immediate labour shortages. And the point that Paul's making there about, you know, are we as connected as we can be to be as agile and responsive as we need to be? Bearing in mind, yes, demography, systemic issues need to be dealt with, but are there things that we can move more rapidly on to mitigate some of the kind of real immediate pressures that we have?
I'll pick up on a couple of points, and Paul's, you know, I think quite rightly challenging our national agencies aligned around a common agenda. I'm slightly more positive about that. I think we are aligned around a really common agenda, and that's about the need to align the investment that we make in skills behind economic opportunity, but the recognition of where the opportunities are, you know, now in the future around digital and green jobs. Recognising the need for a variety of routes for people to acquire skills. And I think actually in listening to Marie this morning and listening to the work that's going on in the colleges with Paul, we're actually seeing the emergence of a really strong focus in upskilling and reskilling as a core part of our skills, the role for our skills system. And I think that's been born through flexibility and agility and responsiveness to the challenges that we're facing as a result of both COVID, Brexit and a challenging labour market. That needs to be a consistent focus for the skills system, I think, going forward over the next 10 to 15 years, because we know demography is going to be tight. We know the economy is rapidly changing, and that pace of increase is not going to do anything but speed up. So, you know, having the tools in our armoury to be able to respond quickly and effectively is really important. And while the Transition Training Fund has been really important this year, it is only but a small proportion of the total investment that we make in skills. So the challenge is yes, to make best use of some of the additional funds that are available at the moment, but actually to really focus that long-term investment, the long-term commitment in the skills system, towards the challenges of the next 10 years, not the challenges of the last 10. In terms of and forgive me, I've forgotten the sectors you mentioned.
Retail and construction, we're taking a particular interest in.
Yeah, retail and construction, I think, are two slightly different sectors in terms of the challenges they're facing. In terms of retail, one of the things that COVID has done, it's not many things, but one of the things it's done is it's just sped up transitions that we knew were already underway. The shift to online retail over the 18 months of the pandemic was huge, and I can't remember the exact percentage figures, but essentially the shift to online retail that you would have expected in 10 years took place in 18 months. You look at the challenges that we've got in terms of people not fully being back in the offices, and it's clear that the retail sector is challenged. There are some skill shortages there at the moment. I think part of those are around attractiveness of some jobs and the competitiveness of the labour market. The challenge in retail is actually to ensure that we're providing pathways for people to find other newer productive jobs. And again, some of the work that we've heard this morning is targeted very much in that space. Construction is an interesting challenge, and the construction sector has been beset by skill shortages and labour shortages of some kind for as long as I've been in kind of the professional world. So this is not a new issue. I think the challenge that construction sector is facing at the moment is undeniably around labour shortages. So we know that that was a sector that was quite reliant on EU nationals, and that has exacerbated some of the existing skill shortages. The other big challenge for the construction sector at the moment is about facing in to the opportunities and the scale of the opportunities and the challenge that the transition to net zero kind of places. We're working with partners in Glasgow, we're working with the partners in the south of Scotland to understand what the specific skills requirements are and the scale of people who will be required for the retrofit of housing or for the development of new building projects. And that's clear that that is a major opportunity. But it's going to need us to train more people in traditional trades, in building trades, in plumbing, in electricians. It's going to mean that at a later stage we may have to reskill those people to respond to new and adopting technologies. So both of those sectors are facing pressures, but I think for quite different reasons at the moment.
And just on that, and I think Alexander might want to be in this area as well, but particularly on construction, with the opportunities of net zero, with the Rich's comments about choking just now in terms of labour supply, is there a danger that immediate pressures might not allow us to get that trajectory of long-term careers in construction that can be dual fuel, and you're talking about reskilling later on? Is there not a real impact? You know, is there an issue to make it attractive? We should be actually trying to get that kind of modern dual fuel type kind of training going on now, in order to make it attractive, because why would people want to go into a career in an area where perhaps it will be overtaken by events as we move into renewable energies?
So we're working on kind of three axes at the moment. One is about ensuring that the apprenticeship frameworks and the qualification frameworks actually respond to and reflect transition to net zero. The second is actually a recognition that we almost certainly need more people in those trades. So one of the things that we're considering at the moment is how we can best incentivise uptake in apprenticeships around construction trades. And that's really with an eye to the next 5 years, when we know that the transition to net zero is really going to take off. So it's about training now for the challenges of the future. And the third part is looking at immediate opportunities around upskilling and reskilling. We're working with Jim Brown at the Energy Skills Partnership in particular to ensure that a lot of the work that's going through the colleges is actually responding to those challenges as well. So as always, there is more than one solution to what is quite a complex set of problems.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll bring in Alexander Burnett, followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, convener, and very much. If I could continue where on third is our awareness and the alignment of our skills training. So, question for Chris. I don't know if you had a chance to look at any of the other submissions, but the one from Scottish Renewables highlights 14 skill sets, categories where they will see an increased demand and potential shortages. I'm not expecting you to have the exact number at your fingertips, but I was wondering if you could give us some understanding of your confidence in figures that you work with. So would you, looking at heat pump installers, for example, would you have a number for that particular skill? And can you describe how you reach that figure, both in assessing and in the delivery? And also, do you hold any sort of geographical spread of those figures? That's for Chris, please.
Thank you. I'm afraid I don't have a number. You possibly saw me looking through my extensive briefing, and of course there is not a number in there. So let me talk you through what we are doing to wrestle with that particular problem. So in Glasgow at the moment, we're working with the City Region partners to look at the investment profile in terms of the retrofit of housing. And we're engaging directly with employers to understand the extent to which skills that are already there in the workforce will be fit for purpose to meet that requirement, and the extent to which skills will need to be remodelled. What we're also looking to do is to build a model, in simple terms, a conversion. You know, £1 million worth of investment in X equals Y number of jobs. I would treat all of those things with a bit of caution, because they run the danger of being spuriously accurate. What I think they're really important in understanding is signalling whether we're investing enough kind of in those trades, in those skills at this moment in time. The routes to which you can do that, I think, are also broad. Yes, it's about potentially incentivising employers and individuals to consider a career in those spaces. It is about careers as well. It's also about ensuring that we've got, you know, the assets that are the college system of the City Region coming behind that. So we're just at the moment embarking on a piece of work with Scottish Funding Council, with the Glasgow City Region partners, to take that approach that we've got around retrofit and play that out across the City Region. Where I think that gets us to is a shared understanding and position of the scale of the challenge, what needs to be done to fix it, and the levels of investment that are going to be required to unlock that opportunity.
Thank you very much. Like I said, I wasn't expecting you to have all those fingertips. I'd be grateful maybe if in your submission afterwards you maybe could put a bit of detail around particularly heat pump installers, but maybe if you're able to have any figures on the other categories that Scottish Renewables mention. My second question is to Richard McClellan. Unite Scotland have talked about the implementation of an offshore training passport to allow workers to move freely before the offshore and onshore energy sectors. I just wondered how feasible, I'm not familiar with which training bodies or which certification bodies we're talking about exactly. I'm hoping you might be more knowledgeable on that. But is such a passport feasible? And if it is, could you outline what is the process for achieving that and how long would it take to achieve?
I have a pretty negative view of these registration schemes because, in my opinion, what happens is qualifications and standards and apprenticeships become more about the plastic card or the registration scheme or the passport than they do about the qualification that you do to get that registration. So I wouldn't be supportive of any sort of passport or registration scheme.
Okay, thanks for that. Do any of the other members of the panel have any views on Unite's suggestion?
I don't know the specific suggestion, but I would say in terms of offshore, the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency provides a kind of regulatory body for work in offshore, and it would obviously, it could be contacted in terms of its expertise in regulation, maybe to improve, you know, some of the standards in terms of that. But a passport only takes you so far, but I think my colleague's right. When you get there, you have to actually deliver and you have to have the skills at a required level. So in a sense, it's getting the right person in the right place at the right time with the right skill levels. And there's an art to doing that. And, a passport is indicative of that journey, but it doesn't actually confirm that that your skills are still current or indeed that you're upskilled. And I think the World Economic Forum talks about in their last projections that you know, coming out of this pandemic, we need to reskill 1 billion people. Now, that's reskilling 1 billion people. That isn't upskilling 1 billion. You can probably add that number. So, yeah, of course, you need to have that documented and a passport, but I think actually inherently it has to be at the right level.
I suppose I'll just, if you don't mind, I'll come in, Alexander. I suppose the crux of the question is transferable skills. And to go back to Richard, I don't know, qualifications for industry, if you see that as part of kind of future-proofing the workforce, because you talked about the difficulty of recruiting people into the sector. If it was a more flexible qualification where it recognises emerging industries, is that part of the thinking of qualifications for industry to look for awarding qualifications that give workers more flexibility to move between sectors?
The whole idea of qualifications for industry, from my point of view, was to allow us to compete in that qualifications and apprenticeships market with other awarding organisations. So that's why we went into the sector. In relation to the transferability of skills and whatever, we again, personally, as an employer, I feel the difficulty is it's not only getting the skills, it's being able to pay a salary that allows people, say, to move from Ayr up to Edinburgh and live in Edinburgh and undertake a job in Edinburgh when accommodation is much more costly up here. So you're having to compete in terms of salary and you're having to compete in terms of what career you're offering people. That's really all I can say on that one.
That's helpful. Thank you. Sorry, Alexander, was there anything else you wanted to come in on?
No, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I suppose this question really follows on from the point Alexander was making regarding oil and gas in particular. There's a lot of focus on the immediate challenges we face over labour and skill shortages, but we know, not least as a result of COP26 last week, governments are going to be making decisions that will mean that many people in existing jobs are going to lose those jobs. And we're told that's fine because we'll have a just transition and people will simply move into the new green jobs. But one of the issues that the committee heard last week is that there isn't really a truly comprehensive understanding of what many of those jobs will be to deliver that just transition, never mind a proper map of what the skills are that will be needed to do that. Do you think that's a fair criticism? I'll put Chris on the spot and kick off with yourself, Chris.
If the question you're asking is, do we know exactly what jobs will emerge over the next kind of 15 to 25 years, the answer to that has got to be no. The transition to net zero is a major undertaking, a transformational undertaking for the Scottish economy. It will require the deployment and adoption of, in some cases, technologies that are not even invented. So, you know, to be able to have that certainty, to say in 25 years we're going to need 2,000 hydrogen engineers in Lerwick, no one can give that certainty at the moment. What we do have is certainty in terms of the investment programme over the next 3 to 5 years set out in the government's climate change update plan. What that's saying to us is that we know the areas where we need to act fast and we need to act quickly are around energy generation, they're around decarbonisation of transport, they're around the decarbonisation of heat in domestic settings and commercial settings, and that's where our early focus is on getting into some of these detailed issues around understanding job requirements, skills content, have we got the provision in place. When we published the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan last year, I emphasised to our board and indeed to our colleagues in government that I saw this as a 15-year undertaking. So in addition to the short-term focus, what we've got in areas of certainty, we have got work that's actively scanning, working with industry, what those technologies are, what the likely implications of those technologies are for skills, so that when things do become more certain in 2026 or 2030, that we've got a basis in which to move early. But it would be unrealistic to expect us to expect anyone to have that picture of 100% certainty over the next 15 years out to 2035.
Do you think the work that we are doing, though, has been done with the urgency that's needed, given that the challenges we face? We know that so the government have a climate change plan, but that's going to change. And are we geared up to be able to adapt and make sure that we can do that planning work that's going to be needed? I mean, whose role, I suppose, is it to really do that? Is it all the individual organisations that are here to do their own work? Is there something else that's needed to really grab this issue and run with it in a comprehensive way?
So what I can speak on with a degree of confidence is the work that we're doing in relation to the skills activity, and that the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, which we published with Scottish Government last year, involved the college sector, the university sector, industry, trade unions, the enterprise agencies. So this is a kind of collective effort, is the first point I'd make. In terms of the urgency that we're taking and responding to the skills implications, I of course would argue that we are acting with pace and we're acting with determination. The Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan is overseen by an implementation steering group that includes all those agencies that saw. We're considering both the progress that we've made over the last 12 months, which is significant in terms of the commitments that were made at the plan, that were set out in the plan 12 months ago. We are also looking at how we lay the foundations for developing that understanding that I think you're driving at, which is, you know, do we know where the transition to net zero is going to hit the ground? Do we know what the skills implications are? Are we ready to signal that into the college and university system? Are we ready to amend our upskilling and reskilling provision towards that? I would argue that we're in as good a place as we can be at this moment in time.
Thanks for that, Chris. Can I put the same question, I suppose, to Mary? I mean, is Open University geared up for this? I mean, are you making the changes in your courses to meet those skill shortages?
Yeah, I mean, I think as Chris was saying, the universities and the colleges are all part of this, and I mean, I think the key thing there is transition. So what we are looking at, particularly at the Open University, is how can we help make people make that transition, and part of that is due through the kind of part-time education and being able to reskill while you're still in that job. So it's very much about the transition between one sector and another. So yes, we are looking at sustainability and at green careers and working with SDS and others. We've just recently launched 3 sustainability micro-credentials, which we one of them yesterday, which are in kind of sustainability and things. So yes, we're looking very much at where we need to get to. I mean, I think one of the, as Chris was saying, there's a direction of travel, but we don't know where it is yet. But we need to be able to be flexible and adaptable. And I think one of the key successes that you have in Scotland is that you've got a very joined up, you know, education system. The colleges work very closely with universities, we work with schools, but actually that can be built upon more. You know, we need to begin into schools and actually training up kids in, you know, renewable technologies, then onto colleges and then universities and pathways.
Well, existing workers, so there's always a focus on going into schools, but actually you should be going into oil rigs. That's where you should be going. You know, speaking to existing workers, I mean, what's been done to really help people that are in existing jobs, but those jobs are going to disappear soon?
We're working in the Cromarty Firth project at the moment, looking at them and doing effectively skills gap analysis on the staff at the moment to actually see where what skills they've got, what transferable skills we can actually help them to develop. And because some of these skills will be those transferable skills, the meta skills that you hear about. You know, it's not all about the kind of technical skills that people need. It's actually about the, you know, transferable skills, the adaptability, the innovation. You know, who are the leaders of the future who are actually looking at these areas and actually industry telling us where the just transition will be, what the skills are actually needed, because we need to work closely with industry. And I think we all need to get better at that, you know, systematically about joining up industry, education, people at Skills Development Scotland to actually say, well, what is coming down the line? What are industry telling us? And actually, how can we get that training out to people before the skills gap hits? You know, how can we transition people into it? So yes, we are working with industries, oil and gas, technology people. As I said, Cromarty Firth is one of the areas that we're up there working with at the moment to look at that.
Okay. The same question to Paul. I mean, feel free to tell us if us policymakers are not doing enough to help you do this job. I mean, one of the issues, Paul, for example, you'll get in a college, particularly in a rural area, is that it's quite easy to deliver a course in something where there's a demand of 20 or 30 students, because that makes it financially viable to do that. But if you need 10 very specialist engineers, it's just not financially viable to do that, because you can't run that class. Is there something we need to be doing to make sure that we support colleges to deliver that work?
Yeah, great question. Well, I'm frustrated that the Comerford Little Report hasn't been fully implemented, because it provided the blueprint for many of the questions that this whole panel is asking. And I think the challenge of the pandemic coming 1 month after that has kind of offset that. Now, of course, the Funding Council and Scottish Government has included parts of that, but actually there's been a bit of cherry picking, and what we're arguing for is a whole system approach, an aligned approach. So in one sense, is enough being done? No. What more could be done? Well, immediately implement and encourage the implementation plan of the Comerford Little Report. That was a report asked for by Scottish ministers to help economic renewal and development and upskilling and reskilling. It was produced, and it was allegedly superseded by other reports. I don't believe it has been, as one of the two authors, along with Audrey Comerford, two very experienced practitioners with over half a century of skills knowledge in them. So in first sense, you really do need to implement the Comerford Little Report as a blueprint with all the recommendations it had, without cherry picking those. I think, you know, the college sector has got some lead solutions to you. For example, NESCOL and Shetland colleges can clearly play a frontline role in supporting that, but actually so can colleges like City of Glasgow, because the oil and gas industry depends on transport and maritime transport, and City of Glasgow is a world leader in maritime education and training, and that was evidenced by the convening power we had to have the shipping industry come to City of Glasgow during COP and spend 2 weeks there. In terms of, so you've got those, the whole transport skills and the whole maritime skills, and indeed, as we touched on earlier with Fiona's question about the whole supply chain skills that are going to be needed for the oil and gas industry. But then in addition to that, the college sector has got the Energy Skills Partnership, which was mentioned before, and more attention needs to be paid to that, more funding needs to go to that. But also, quite honestly, the Advanced Manufacturer Training Network, where 17 colleges are engaged in. And partly to a little bit to go back to Alexander's point, you know, in terms of some of those kind of green skills, you know, the Glasgow City region has identified 75,000 jobs from green skills. So many of the people who work in oil and gas live in the Central Belt, not exclusively, I understand that, but there's another opportunity for those individuals who have chosen to either, if you like, retrain That all can be provided, and I've identified with my colleagues 13 different areas involved in, if you like, housing retrofit skills alone. So clearly work is being done to support the oil and gas industry. It's an important area for Scotland, but clearly much more can be done to kind of pump prime the whole skills infrastructure that Scotland really needs.
That's very helpful. Well, I won't ask, I'm going to ask Richard to come, and I won't ask anybody any other questions, I'm conscious of time, but if Mary or Chris do want to come back on what else the policymakers can do to assist you, then that would you know, feel free to do that. But I'll put the same question to you, Richard. I mean, you'll be adapting the qualifications you need for the sectors. Is there anything we can do to assist that, and what work are you doing at the moment?
Well, my awarding body is totally reliant on the qualifications that are developed through the likes of CITB, working with sector skills councils and employers. We offer regulated qualifications, and we find it's very, very difficult to improve those regulated qualifications to get what we need, the information back to those who make the decisions in terms of updating frameworks and whatever. You know, I've got quite a few points I wouldn't mind making in relation to how qualifications are put together in Scotland. I can maybe provide some ideas afterwards.
I'll leave that to the chair if you want to do that just now.
You could go ahead just now, yeah. Mr. McClelland, if you like to.
Well, the biggest challenge for us in relation to apprenticeships is how those apprenticeships are added to frameworks and the contribution made by sector skills councils to those frameworks. And sometimes we find there's a whole different agenda. You've asked a question about registration schemes, so you can have a whole framework, but the driver for that framework is to get people more cards, as opposed to the framework being there to, you know, increase people's skills. So we've had a lot of instances where, in fact, we were, as a business, you know, I've had three businesses that are education related. One we had to wind up because of the situation here in Scotland in relation to the delivery of apprenticeships. It's probably not what Skills Development Scotland wants to hear, but it was a pretty negative experience. You know, we were at the cutting edge of apprenticeships and qualifications for the extractive sector, the quarrying sector, and there was a situation that arose where a particular organisation was able to influence the frameworks so that they were the only organisation that could provide the qualifications, which meant we couldn't provide a service in the sector, and we were driven out of that sector. So if you're asking me what can government do about these things, they could look at things like the conflict of interest problems that are in the education sector and in the apprenticeship sector, and do something about that.
That's very useful. I don't know if Chris, I'm not going to give you a rebuttal, Chris, but I just, you tell, and Mary as well, if there's anything you think that we should be doing to assist you in doing that job. I mean, one of the things that you'll know yourself, Chris, and I've in the past, but this is just that whole flexibility around apprenticeships. I was at a business South of Scotland last week that talked about why is apprenticeships not 3 years, not 2 years. You know, there was that whole flexibility to meet those challenges. But I don't know if there's anything you think that we could be doing to assist.
I'm going to make two.
Sorry to interrupt. Can I ask for a brief response? We are getting a bit short of time, and I'm waiting to bring Gordon in. But please do answer.
I'm going to make two very brief responses. So I know you're not going to allow me a rebuttal, and I don't think the committee's had time to have a discussion about the Scottish apprenticeship system versus the English apprenticeship system. But there's a lot of things that Richard said that I just don't recognise. Scottish apprenticeships are signed off by the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board. Apprenticeship qualifications and frameworks are signed off by industry. We have got a heavy programme of work that's well underway to ensure that apprenticeship standards are fit for purpose and facing into the future. So I'd be happy to pick that up with Richard out with the confines of the committee. In terms of flexibility in apprenticeships, we are absolutely looking at how we can ensure that apprenticeships are a tool that work for as many employers as possible. In the south of Scotland at the moment, we're working with SOCI, the two local councils, to pilot shared apprenticeship models in a range of sectors. That works very close to completion. And I'm really confident that we will be able to introduce some innovation into how we deliver apprenticeships in the south of Scotland in particular, but roll that out to employers right across the country.
Okay, thank you. And Mary, would you like to briefly respond?
Just briefly on 2 points. First one on apprenticeships. So as a university, we deal only in graduate apprenticeships. And I think to Chris's point there, I think the frameworks that have been established with industry, what we would like to see, and I think this is already ongoing, is actually the framework's been expanded out into other sectors. So in terms of the work that we are doing right across the country, we've been seeing real demand for things like social work apprenticeships, and particularly in health and social care, you know, for healthcare assistant apprenticeships at a kind of graduate level and management level. Those haven't came through yet. A lot of them are technical and, you know, in the kind of skills area that have been absolutely needed. But we would like to see those expanding. And just on the flexibility part as well, because the Open University works with such a diverse population in terms of widening access, we'd really like to be able to see a flexibility in that model, which isn't just a kind of full year, full-time degree. Because we see quite a lot of people who've got caring responsibilities, maybe going off on maternity leave, maybe being sick, having to come off an apprenticeship programme and then came back on it again, rather than being able to flex that up and down in terms of part-time and flexible. And that's actually starting to impact on the equalities part of apprenticeships for us, that we're seeing more men taking them rather than women. So we'd like to be able to work with SDS, and we're already starting to have some of these conversations about that model with SDS and SFC. On the other question about what government and others can do on that, I think in terms of not just oil and gas but in all sectors, I think we would say funding and parity of esteem for part-time education as in full-time. If you are a part-time learner, you don't get access to maintenance support, you don't get access to council tax rebate. If you're a care experience student over 25, you don't get access to the care experience bursary. And if you're part-time, you don't get that either. So there's elements of things that can happen probably quite quickly that could actually make a big difference to that. The part-time fee grant effectively is the only show in town at the moment, and if you earn over £25,000, you have to pay the fee. So what we would like to see is government, and we've seen this in the SFC review, the recommendations from that at the moment about modular learning, about part-time and about lifelong learning, and that system actually not being about one chance at a degree, actually about having, you know, a learning allowance that enables people to be able to draw that down throughout their lifetime. We think that would make a huge difference to people being able to transition from career into career, and more support particularly for SMEs. We've seen this with Flexible Workforce Development Fund enabling people to have £5,000, and we've seen demand from that in the college sector and also from ourselves. But the key thing here is 99.3% of businesses in Scotland are SMEs, and they're telling us that the difficulties that they've got are funding and time. Time is a massive thing. Actually not being able to backfill, and particularly, you know, the uncertainty around about Brexit and particularly COVID has meant that SMEs, you know, they're struggling to keep up and struggling to actually keep the staff that they've got. So the kind of the flexibility of being able to help support SMEs in terms of funding, they are willing. I mean, I think 51% of them said that they're going to increase their funding budget this year, their training budget, but they're still looking for a bit more support on that in terms of time and effort. So very long-winded answer to something that was supposed to be short, but that would be my plea.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Thanks very much, convener. A lot of the areas I was wanting to ask questions on have been covered, but there's a couple of points I just wanted a bit of clarification on. The first one is we've talked a lot about upskilling and reskilling of the existing workforce, but in the SDS paper we've got, it highlights that Scottish businesses who provide training for staff has fallen from 70% to 59% over the last 7 or 8 years. And I was just wondering, Chris, as a starter, if you could maybe give some background to that.
Yeah, sure. It's a purely factual position, but let me just explain the factors that are sitting behind that. So that data is pulled from something called the Employer Skills Survey, which takes place every 2 years. The survey wasn't undertaken in 2019, but it was undertaken in 2020. The fieldwork took place between October 2020 and December 2020. And we know that was right in the midst of us moving back into a second wave of restrictions. So I think that 2020 figure is absolutely an outlier and is explained by the economic restrictions that we're quite rightly facing in respect to the pandemic.
So do you think, I mean, we have over a long period of time been fairly consistent prior to that in the number of businesses that were training staff. So do you think if that's an outlier that we're probably lying roughly where we were pre-pandemic?
I have a terrible record in terms of predictions and bets. I'm not going to comment on where we are now. What I will say is looking over the period from kind of 2013 to 2017, you're right, the percentage of employers in Scotland who were providing training to their staff was fairly consistent at around 70%. That was slightly above the kind of UK level. So if you were to assume, and it's a dangerous thing, that things post-COVID are going to be the same as pre-COVID, you would be right. But I'm not willing to slap a bet on that.
And the only other issue I was wanting to cover, we spoke earlier on about the problems of people supply. And we've seen a whole range of vacancies from HGV drivers to people in the agricultural industry, to hospitality, manufacturing, construction and so on. What should the Scottish or indeed the UK government to do immediately to try and address these issues? We've had various calls from Visit Scotland, Scottish Chambers of Commerce and also the Royal Society of Edinburgh asking for the UK government predominantly to intervene. And I'm just wondering what your views were about how we improve the people supply.
I want to just say a couple of things about why I think we're facing this people supply crunch at the moment. Part of that is down, as I said earlier, to the implication of Brexit and EU nationals potentially leaving the country and not coming back in. Part of it is down to economic inactivity. Part of it is down to just the relentless kind of pressure of Scotland's underlying demographics. So those three things combined means for me there is no kind of one simple answer or response. I think the response that we need to have needs to be quite broad-reaching. I think where there's a case to be made to be bringing in workers and short-term visas has been made for certain sectors. We should be looking at that as an opportunity to close gaps. I think we need to look hard at what we can do to bring those people who are not currently engaged in the labour market for whatever reason, whether it be because you know they've got health issues, whether they think there's no jobs out there, whether they are looking for a job. We need to have a focus on that group on broadening kind of the labour supply. I think we also need to think a little bit more long term as well. And it is important that we face the short term pressures, but we need to look at how long term we can turn round some of these challenges. And actually, I think the role that Paul's institution plays and universities play in terms of attracting talent into Scotland is potentially really important. If we can find a way of actually locking them in here for 3, 5, 25, 50 years afterwards, those things combined will all contribute to sorting the long-term challenge which is causing the issues we're seeing at the moment.
Okay. Does anybody else want to come in on that issue?
I think I was name-checked, so thanks, Chris. Maybe for clarity's sake, between City Glasgow College and Edinburgh College, we attract every year 7,000 international students. Now, that's not often recognised. Usually that's more synonymous with universities. And it's, you know, it's often the plaintiff of colleges is they don't get enough airtime. In fact, I would argue they don't get enough funding. And you know, it's Cumberford Little, we evidence that, where, you know, beggars belief why only a third of tertiary funding goes to colleges, two-thirds goes to university, and that's in teaching side. I could understand if that was university, but I can't really understand it why only a third goes to the teaching side. So I think if you look at that international reputation that Scotland's colleges, not just those two institutions, other institutions have you know, international and national reputations for their areas, I think that's a good example. You know, that, you know, we've got a very good starting point to do that. But I think beyond that, you know, it was mentioned earlier on about, you know, working with industry, and there's at least across Scotland's colleges some 30,000 day release students. And that's another way. I think personally, we're past peak degree. I think we have to get into a situation of more agile responses, more in work training, more release training. Shorter bite-sized pieces of learning. I think the future will demand that, and I think the young people and the employees will demand that too.
Okay. Marie?
the Open University is working across all four nations of the UK, so we're speaking to each of the governments in each of the areas, and the kind of key focus of each of them, very different obviously, but the key focus of each of them is about this skills part and how we can reskill people. So we are effectively lobbying on behalf of ourselves, but obviously the entire education system, colleges and universities, about the flexible nature of both funding and provision to be able to reskill and upskill people as quickly as possible. And whether that is, you know, a short-term, you know, 30-credit module in a particular area, or whether that's a pathway that enables people to study in chunks and actually then, you know, bring them in from different institutions and have a pathway towards a degree, because a degree is still a very, very valuable qualification. And we're talking about things like green skills and technologies. These aren't things that we can just upskill someone in 10 weeks. You know, there are trades here that need to be reskilled as well, but actually being able to do it in a flexible fashion. So I think the funding and the support for students, whether they be part-time or full-time, whether they be young, whether they be throughout their career, whether they be graduates, graduate apprentices, or whether they be learners, I think is important. And if we can do that systematically in Scotland or across the UK, whether that be, you mentioned the UK government there as well, if we can do that systematically as possible and we can provide that at scale and we can work with partners like the college sector in Scotland to be able to kind of support that education as well. I think, as I said earlier, There is an envious position about Scotland's tertiary education system. I was speaking to people in the skills system in Northern Ireland last week, and they were talking about, you know, the way that there is a pathway through the SEQF framework, and actually the ability of colleges and universities and actually the industrial sector to work together is envied. So I wouldn't be throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Build on what we've got. But actually the funding is critical to that, and the kind of modular, flexible, work-based part of that as well is really important if we're going to make sure that we can get to people as quickly as possible when these skills gaps happen now and in the future, and be able to kind of predict those as well.
Okay. Richard, do you get anything to add?
I suppose the only point I would make about HGV drivers is that in the construction industry, you've got people working at the most basic of levels, you know, your general operative. And people, every person in work is looking for career progression. And in the construction sector, you know, a labourer for a number of years might want to progress to driving a machine. So in the same way as a construction worker wants to drive a machine, there'd be a lot of people out there who want to drive vehicles and see that as a progression. And if it could be promoted as some form of career progression to get people seeing themselves as moving on and progressing through getting qualified and skilled in relation to operating vehicles.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Jamie Halcrow-Johnson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, convener, and morning to the committee and panellists. I'm sorry that I'm not able to be with you today, and I hope you can hear me okay. It's blowing a bit of a hooli here at the moment, so apologies if I'm slightly disrupted. A lot of the areas have already been covered. I just did want to kind of highlight, I think, one of the things Marie Henry said about parity of esteem, and just give my support to that. I think it's vital. As somebody that was a former spokesman on skills for my party and convener of the DPG on skills, I think it's a vital area, as is support for small and medium enterprises as well. It's an area that we need to do more to try and encourage and support getting involved. I suppose the first question I was going to kind of, I'd really quite like to ask, it's something that's been covered, but it's really just to get a confirmation from Chris Brodie. I wonder if you could remind us of the number of vacancies there are across Scotland at the moment compared to those economically inactive, because I thought that was really interesting what you were saying. And do you think that we're doing enough to get those economically inactive back into work, whether that's supporting them or other ways of encouraging them? I suppose is the balance of carrot and stick, to use a very crude term, right at the moment, and what more could we be doing? If I can put that to Chris Brodie, please.
I'm afraid I'm going to disappoint you again in terms of being able to provide a specific number of job vacancies in Scotland. That number's unfortunately not stuck in my head. What I can say with a strong degree of confidence is that the number of job vacancies that we're seeing advertised at the moment is above pre-pandemic levels, and I'll be happy to confirm kind of those numbers in writing. I want to come back again to, and I have got a figure that is in my head that I haven't shared. So the Institute for Employment Studies has just looked at mobility in the jobs market over the last 3 months, and across the UK, 2.2 million people moved job or changed job, entered a job in the summer months. That's an absolutely phenomenal number and is the highest number for something like 30 years. And that's been driven by people returning to work as well as people changing jobs. So there is mobility kind of taking place in the labour market at the moment. Forgive me, I've now forgotten the second part of your question while I try to remember numbers. So would you be okay to repeat that?
Well, it was really, as I say, I suppose what I'm trying to get at is, or trying to find out is, of that labour shortage or supply shortage, how much of that can be met by existing those existing economically inactive, and kind of those economically inactive may not be suitable, suitable for some of the positions out there. But it was really about whether the balance is right between encouraging those and supporting those people back into the workplace. You know, is the balance between supporting them and, you know, other more forceful ways of encouraging them to get back into the workplace, are they correct at the moment?
SDS doesn't have direct responsibility, so I have the joy of being a commentator rather than a deliverer in this agent in this area. There's 823,000 people who are economically inactive in Scotland. I think that number's a little bit misleading. I think the group we should be focusing on are those who are economically inactive and who are looking to get back into work, and that's in the region of 157,000 people. Some of the mechanisms that we have in place in SDS will be available to those people through National Transition Training Fund. The route of upskilling through of university, through colleges, is also open to them. I think the bigger, longer-term challenge for us, and I understand why we're very focused on short-term pressures at the moment, is how do we build strength and capacity in the working-age population over the long term? And I think that leads you to actually looking at those who are choosing, who are not working because they have perhaps an illness, or they perhaps have some challenge that prevents them from getting back into the labour market. We are seeing investment in some of those underlying causes, for example, around childcare. I think there needs to be a strong focus from employers as well. And I think we're already beginning to see this, where in response to labour shortages, what employers are doing are looking at amendment of job roles, are looking into kind of different markets, different demographics, rather, that they wouldn't have considered. The digital technology sector is a great example of this, where the way that they're responding to some of the challenges that they're facing is actually from actively recruiting from neurodiverse groups. So I think there's a danger when we sit in front of the committee that we assume that we are the only ones who've got the responsibility for fixing this. I think there's a big responsibility on employers to think hard about how they best secure their talent pipelines over the future.
Thanks very much. If I can stay with you, Chris, another area that we've looked at and has come up again and again has been automation. And, you know, we're obviously seeing, progression in various areas in terms of automation. We're also likely to see potential changes, for example, in how we meet things like climate change, trying to get more freight off the road. How does that impact the need for HGV drivers? If we're looking at more local sourcing, which again it could be a positive rather than negative, how that impacts on demand, a need within certain sectors. So, can I ask of you how Skills Development Scotland engage with business in terms of those future needs, where automation is likely to lead to either pressures or relieve pressures in certain areas? How easy is it to do that, and how kind of on the ball, if again kind of maybe a slightly unfair term, but how do you think you are in terms of where you think automation might be able to relieve some of the pressures going forward?
Sure. I'll answer the question in two parts. One is about how we engage, and two about how on the ball that is, because I think they are slightly separate. Our engagement with industry is pretty deep and wide-ranging. Over the last 10 years, we've established an infrastructure in the shape of industry leadership skills groups. So we've published a series of sectoral skills investment plans, and we keep that work live. That is essentially based on the premise that we inform our skills investment plans and our own apprenticeship programmes of investment skills driven by what employers are telling us is going on in their sector. So we're picking up evidence already of automation becoming a really hot issue in elements of food and drink. We're seeing automation playing out really heavily in terms of advanced manufacturing, as it has been for a number of years. And the implication of that is that in the medium to long term, perhaps fewer people will be needed to kind of service those industries. What we're also hearing is about the limits of automation. And in some settings in particular, you know, tourism and hospitality is an example where you can, but actually sometimes the customer experience is not what a business wants to deliver. So it will play out separately. It will play out differently in different areas. I said I would come on to how on the ball is that. That's not an easy question to answer across the piece. But what I would say is, you know, our approach is based on, you know, yes, us understanding that as an agency, but also on understanding where employers and where industries are at. And that is reliant on, you know, how far sighted employers are about the changes that are coming down the track.
Thanks very much. That's kind of really what I've got. I don't know if there's anybody else on the panel that would like to come in on that, convener.
Is there any? I'll take Mary, and then I'll need to move on to Colin Beattie, who will be the final questioner.
Just thank you, Chair. Just a really quick point, and maybe an example on the economically inactive part of the question, and maybe just an example of something that we've undertaken. So with funding from Skills Development Scotland and their Digital Start Fund during the pandemic, we worked with the Department for Work and Pensions and took 100 people who had been long-term unemployed through a 13-week coding skills course that gave them industry certification at the end of it. And at the end of that programme, we also worked with employers and in a kind of careers capacity as well. At the end of that 13-week programme, we got 10 people jobs in the tech sector. Now, they'd been long-term unemployed, and one of the participants actually cried because they didn't actually think that they could ever do a university-level qualification, never mind get back into the job. So I think part of attracting and being able to get to the economically inactive people is about us working in partnership. So providers working in partnership with business, working in partnership with the agencies like Department for Work and Pensions, but also those agencies in the third sector who are working with people who are economically inactive and actually finding the right thing for them that there's a job at the end of. So we can do it. And I think because particularly the OU can do that because we've got open access. But that actually means it's open access to the entire education system. It's not just to an OU qualification. We can do the first part of it and then pass them on to Paul's College or other colleges, or pass them back into industry again because they're part qualified. So actually it's about finding, it's working in partnership that's really key for this, and that's what we do quite a lot of. But we might be able to play a kind of part in that. So it's just an example to show some of the stuff that can be done if we get the funding right, we get to the right people and we provide them with a job at the end of it. And that's in a really quick time frame as well.
Hey, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mira. I think having had the opportunity to listen to all that's gone before, there's clearly no quick fix to our current problems with the supply chains in terms of the labour shortages, the skills shortages and so on. Chris has mentioned about the 823,000 economically inactive, of whom about 20% are actively looking for work. Is that in line with our competitor economies? It seems a very high figure, but is it in line with our competitor economies? Chris, do you have a figure at your fingertips?
I'm going to have a really stiff conversation with my briefing team at SDS on the numbers that they provide me with. I apologies, I don't have an exact number. What I can do is say a couple of things. So firstly, in terms of where Scotland compares in terms of economic activity to the rest of the UK, the Scottish economic activity rate is typically higher than the rest of the UK. What I would say about that 19% figure, and I'm rarely surprised by numbers. I do, contrary to appearances today, I do work with a lot of numbers. That 19% figure that I've referenced today of economically inactive people looking for work is the lowest proportion of those economically inactive for a long time. And I think there's a story that will emerge from the outcome of the pandemic that we've seen lots of people make the choice to leave the labour market, particularly older workers, particularly older women. Being able to quantify what contribution that's made to, you know, the labour choke that we're seeing at the moment, I'd find difficult to do. But I think that's a kind of an emerging story that we should be keeping an eye on.
It would be interesting if you could give us some comparative figures in terms of with our competitors. It's really important. Just to move on from that, there's 157,000 people are actively looking for work, and there's obviously disconnects with skills and so on. Consistently over the years, we've heard from companies like B&Q that focus on hiring older staff, that they are more productive and more loyal, consistent in their work than perhaps some of the younger workers. So they're clearly a resource that is valued by a lot of these companies. Now, I'm assuming that within that 157,000, there is a proportion of older people looking for work. We're looking for a quick fix in some ways. Is there nothing we can do to tap into these resources better than we are in order to provide immediate cover in certain areas? And maybe ask Paul to, if he's got a view on that.
Yeah, I think, Gordon, you know, for me, we have many of the tools at our disposal here in Scotland. We just need to scale them up and scale them up at pace. And, you know, we talked about Minnows Economic Inactive, and probably the college sector deals with a lot of those students. If you think that one in three of all students in general in all colleges comes from, you know, the most disadvantaged areas, there are deep, deep pockets of disadvantage still in Scotland and deep growing inequality because of the pandemic and 10 years plus of austerity. I think, you know, for the colleges to have a 93% success rate for, if you like, 25% of all higher education to be delivered now in colleges for many of those for older workers and older adults. But, you know, the Comfort Little Report talked about the importance of lifetime learning. Now, in the good old days, that used to be called lifelong learning, but we managed to dismantle that as well. Now, there are reasons why we did that. We had a focus, we had an urgent focus after the last crisis in finance and developing the young workforce. But we seemed to do this to the exclusion of everybody else. You know, as we didn't do the young workforce and we didn't continue any form for the older workforce. So we still have within our colleges the residual infrastructure to do that. And I think, quite honestly, if many of the recommendations in Comfort Little were actually implemented and fast, I know I said that once, so I'm really trying to push that, then quite honestly, after the consultation with all the key stakeholders, I think you will get greater alignment, you will get a greater and a fairer response to the workforce, where you can get the older workers coming in and getting the skills that they need in shorter bits of learning at a level that they want, such as, I mean, where else can you get comparably, and in the UK, I would argue, 23,000 courses to choose from. And we're not, you know, a massively diverse country like England, where it's very fragmented. We're very, very cohesive in that sense. So Scotland, as I said, has got many of the tools, but the narrative isn't shared. The narrative is exclusive. And I think the challenge here is, how do we ensure that the narrative isn't exclusive? How do we ensure it's inclusive? And how do we rebalance and refocus after the pandemic? I think it's a fantastic opportunity to reboot and a fantastic opportunity to give hope to, you know, the workers that Richard's talking about, or the older workers that you're talking about, in lifetime learning. And Comfort Little said, you know, of all the many, many things colleges do, you can in essence describe them as lifetime learning and support for business, particularly symbiotic support for business. So it's there. It's the blueprint's there. Let's actually scale it up at pace.
Richard, is there a way to bring older workers back productively into the supply chain to ease some of the pressures we've got now?
It's like everything else. You just have to encourage them to come back into it and see a valuable contribution they can make. We find in our sector, older workers just love this idea of mentoring the younger people coming through. They see there's a lot of, you know, older construction professionals and civil engineers who just want to mentor your young engineers, want to contribute to their training and their development and their upskilling. It's about making them feel valued and valuable to the sector.
Marie?
Yes, is the answer. You wouldn't think anything other than that from the Open University. I mean, I think the older workforce, I think, has recognised that it can make an amazing contribution, particularly if we are upskilling and reskilling people. And I think one of the great examples of that has been the success of some of the graduate apprenticeship schemes, because a lot of the graduate apprenticeships are actually being used for people who are already in the workplace to be able to upskill. So we're seeing a lot of people who might work in software engineering actually taking on our cybersecurity postgraduate apprenticeships. So it's a way of engaging with staff who are already there to upskill them into the careers and the jobs that the industry needs and that people are getting upskilled into. And the ability of graduate apprenticeships to be able to work with people over 24 means that, but the employers absolutely see the loyalty that they get from that staff. We obviously work with quite a lot of over 25s at the Open University. We work with younger people, but we also work predominantly with the over 25s. And I think, back to my point again, I think if you're going to encourage people to come back into the sector, whether they be economically inactive or whether they need to upskill for careers, it needs to be worthwhile for them. So the skills need to be available there, the training needs to be available for them there that's flexible, that fits in with their lifestyle, because when you're an older learner, you have more life going on at the same time. You might have kids, you might have caring responsibilities, you know, lots of different things that are happening. So the funding needs to be there, the flexibility needs to be there as well. We're doing quite a lot of work in the health and social care sector at the moment, which is obviously a massive area of skills gaps, and being able to look at people who might be working in that sector, training them up to be nurses, doing our introduction to health and social care qualifications, working with the SSSC, utilising both the young workforce but also the workforce that are actually in the care sector at the moment and upskilling them into, you know, managerial careers or into nursing careers as well, because the care sector really sees the older workforce there as being key to that. They've got the skills, they've got the loyalty, you know, we just need to get them trained up and into the kind of higher level skills there as well.
So, Chris, is the older workforce a potential quick fix?
As someone who's rapidly moving to becoming an older part of the workforce, I would say yes. I think we need to exhaust all kind of possibilities for re-engaging people in work. And I'm really kind of encouraged by what I'm hearing from Paul and Marie in terms of the focus of what they're doing. So I wouldn't go as far to say it's a quick fix, but it's an important part of the solution.
OK. Sorry,
thank you. I will just take a brief supplementary which is related from Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. It's actually following on from the theme we're exploring in terms of the role of women. And Chris, you triggered it in your opening remarks, actually talking about economically inactive. Here we go again with the numbers, but I wonder, do you have any statistics as to what percentage of the population are women who are economically inactive? And a second quick general question to all of the panel, to what extent do you routinely disaggregate all data you collect so you're understanding at this time the particular impact on women and the labour market? So hopefully quickly.
So very quickly, no, I don't have those figures to hand, but yes, we will provide and what analysis we can as a supplementary to the committee. In terms of what we do to disaggregate data, we capture data on characteristics of individuals who are participating in our apprenticeship programmes and our other training programmes by a whole range of characteristics. And again, we can provide that as a kind of written supplementary.
Yeah, we do. As a widening access institution, we actively, you know, promote women into careers, particularly in STEM. And we've got, can't remember off the top of my head, but we've got a really high proportion of women in STEM courses, which we're really proud of, obviously. But yeah, we do that, and we also look at it kind of cross-functionally as well. So women with caring responsibilities, women who are carers, women who live in multiple areas of deprivation as well. So we do that kind of cross-sectoral thing to see if there are other aspects to that as well. Yeah.
I'm going to lend Chris on my briefing team for the numbers. When you consider that 75% of the population is kind of women or young people, and when you also look at, you know, my own institution is about 49%, you know, male to 51% female, and that figure oscillates. You also then look at, for example, some of the most disadvantaged we talked about earlier, for example, your mothers trying to learn English to provide, you know, money and benefits for their family. Presently in Glasgow, we were able to support 3,000 of those women in returning to learn that language. But there's actually a waiting list of 10,000 to do those. So, quite honestly, it is the tip of the iceberg, but, you know, it is very much about inclusion, and colleges have for centuries actually been involved in providing those local opportunities, particularly on a part-time learning basis, and that lifetime learning which you go back to, and whether that is superseded now or enhanced by those micro-credentials that we spoke about earlier, that will be a great opportunity to say to a mother or, you know, an elder relative, saying you can actually get a qualification that's recognised, nationally recognised, in after 20 hours. If you said you've got to spend the next 3 to 4 years doing that, they're just not going to do it.
Do you have any comments on, you do work in, it would seem to be predominantly, traditionally male sectors. Do you see an increase in need to attract women into the workforce, and what can be done to support that?
So the only point I would make is it's about making the sector you work in more attractive to people, more attractive to women, and breaking down the jobs into jobs that might not have been considered under, say, the construction industry. But if you start talking about things like, you know, people who work in weighbridges, people who work in labs and material testing, you know, you can open up opportunities that, you know, there's people who start thinking, you know, construction's just about driving a machine or digging a hole. It's about making it more attractive to everybody that might need a job.
That's great, thank you. I'd like to thank all the witnesses this morning, and thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us and contribute to the inquiry.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. I will now move to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the Scottish Government consent notification to a UK statutory instrument. It's in papers 3 and 4. The committee is invited to consider the consent notification for the EFTA and TCA International Agreement Procurement SI. Are members content to consent the notification?
Yes.
We will now move into the private session for the remaining agenda items.